Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. Welcome to the first Q&A video of 2022. Let's take a quick look at the questions for today. First, from Robert Lauden, Gu Yunshen's book, 能说形意全经. Second, from Frederick Gaudin, 河北形意 Branch Differences. A third question from Windrander Warren, 成 style 八卦 and 摔跤. Question number four from Kazox 770, time investment for 神寺. Question number five from 内功 adapt, power cultivation limits. Question number six from anonymous, focus and awareness. Question number seven from Frederick Talk, 历练点脉 and 点穴. Question number eight from Fred Talk, three pillar system in my 100 video. So without any further ado, let's get started. Robert Lauden asks about Gu Yunshen's book, 能说形意全经 and if it's valuable. Thank you, Robert. This is a good question, and actually, I do have a future plan to talk about this topic, but I will answer your question briefly here and do a more detailed video in the future. Yes, Gu Yunshen did write a book titled 郭云深形意全谱 or 郭云深形意 Training Manual. And this is my hand copy version of this book. I hand copied it when I was a teenager. This is a very thin book, but contains a lot of information about 形意 practice. I believe Gu Yunshen's book is one of the best 形意theoretical training documents in history. Bear in mind that this book, along with most other books of that period, mainly focus on theory, not on any specific forms, movements, or routines. The first and the second generations of practitioners focused mainly on theory, and it was actually the third generation of 形意 practitioners that started to add specific practice method, including forms and routines. As a result, later generations of 形意 books mainly focuses on the introduction of forms and routines. Now, let's talk about the book titled 能说形意全经 that you mentioned in your question. The word 能 in the title indicates the book was written by 能, a shortened form of 李洛能, the founder of 形意. I have read this book as well. Unfortunately, I have to tell you that this book was not written by Gu Yunshen. If you read the book title, it says 能说, which implies 李洛能 wrote the book. Actually, it is a 伪经 or fake book. The reason I use the word fake is because the book was not actually written by neither 李洛能nor Gu Yunshen. Actually, it is a book edited by someone about 10 years ago by plagiarizing different paragraphs of some 形意 documents written by 李洛能、郭云深、李存义、薛颠、孙禄堂 and others. For example, its five element parts are plagiarized from 薛颠's book. It is a shame that someone tried to sell a plagiarized document claiming it to be a book written by 李洛能. You may wonder why they would do it. Well, just for money, as simple as that. I hope I have answered your question, Robert. Let's move on to the next one. Frederick Gaudin asked about the differences between the 李存义 Zhang Zhaodong and Xue Dian's branches with respect to Pi, Zuan, Pao, Heng techniques in Xingyi's five elements practice, along with further movement variations in each branch. This is with reference to my Beng Quan variation demonstration in last week's video on Shen Si. Thank you, Frederick. This is a very good question indeed. I mainly focus on practicing these three branches, but actually I have studied almost all of the Hebei branches to some extent, though not as much as my three main branches. In your first question, you are asking about the differences among the three branches on the four elements of Xingyi. My answer is yes, there are differences in body structure, direction of powder in the last movement of each element, and some other details. For example, in fire or pao fist, Li Cunyi punches more forward and slightly downward, and Zhang Zhaodong's movement is more straightforward, while Xue Dian's movement focuses on the power transmission between shoulders. But overall, their external appearances do look a bit different, but internally they are the same. In Hebei style, started by Li Cunyi, besides the classical five-element practice, there are four variations of each element's fist. So, in total, there are 25 different varieties practiced. In other words, for each element, there are five techniques, and the standard five elements commonly practiced nowadays is the first technique of each element. These variations, along with their hand movements, are based on different stepping patterns. I taught many of my students in Montreal these variations. These 25 movements practice was not popular before and isn't popular even nowadays. So many Xingyi practitioners stopped practicing if any of them even knew it to begin with. Almost 5 years ago, I made a video series titled Returning Xingyi Practice to China, in which I introduced this practice. Like I mentioned already, these 20 movements are the auxiliary exercise compared to the standard five-element practice. Xingyi practitioners can add these exercises after mastering the standard five-element fist. Since this practice was created by Li Cunyi, both Zhang Zhaodong and Xue Dian branches practice this 12 movement set as well. However, practice of each of these three branches should reflect the characteristics of it, even though the movements are similar. Fred, I hope I have answered your question. Let's move on to the next question. Wind Rider Wang asks in Daoist Discord, if it is recommended for Cheng-style Bagua practitioners to learn Shuai Jiao to get familiar with throws used in Bagua, or if Cheng-style throws are directly adapted for its unique movement characteristics. I replied to Wind Rider Wang on Discord with a short answer, but I think this deserves a more detailed public answer. Thank you, Wind Rider Wang. This is a good question. Before I answer your question, let me first categorically say that Shuai Jiao is a great practice, and if you want to focus on Shuai Jiao, don't let anyone convince you otherwise. By the way, I practiced a bit of Tianjin wrestling when I was a teenager with some friends of mine. I noticed that understanding some principles of Shuai Jiao and apply those concepts into Bagua is a great solution. Having said that, let me now answer your questions with Cheng-style Bagua practice as your goal in this context. To your first question, it is not at all necessary to study Shuaijiao or Chinese wrestling for Cheng Xiao Bagua. Cheng Tinghua was already a Shuaijiao practitioner before he started learning Bagua from Dong Haichuan, and therefore he added wrestling techniques during the process of development of Cheng Xiao Bagua. Regardless, Cheng Xiao Bagua is still Bagua. In other words, it is the Bagua with added Shuaijiao techniques. Let me give you another example. Xing Yi may seem to be a style with no wrestling techniques, but actually, some Xing Yi techniques also exist in Shuaijiao. But Shuaijiao practice is not at all a prerequisite for Xing Yi, nor is it a prerequisite for Bagua. To your second question, I recommend you just practice Bagua and get the wrestling techniques from the Bagua practice. That is the better solution. In other words, Shuaijiao techniques contained in Bagua should be practiced by working on Bagua. I hope I have answered your question. Win the rider won. Let's move on to the next one. Kazox770 asked three questions about the time investment required to practice and achieve Shen Zi, which was the topic of last week's video. Thanks, Kazox770, for your questions. Let's talk about your question on time investment in terms of hours, days, weeks, and so on. Well, ever since I started martial art practice as a child, I practiced every day on a fixed schedule until the age 22. After that, even though my practice schedule used to vary on account of different obligations, I still managed to carve out a definite chunk of time for practice every single day until the age of 30. After turning 30, since my practice had already reached an advanced level, although I assume even more responsibilities in life after that age, even to this day, I have managed to maintain a good amount of practice every day depending on my schedule. Martial art practice has become a seamless part of my life since I turned 30, as opposed to dedicating a specific time slot earlier. This is my personal experience. In terms of general advice based on personal teaching experience, a serious practitioner should practice at least 3 times per week and 1 or 2 hours for each session. So it should be manageable for most practitioners. Now, let's talk about your second question about achieving something in a shorter time than expected. Well, I have to say that some people are more talented than others in terms of mastering physical movement. But in terms of understanding theory, most people have a similar speed in learning. So, if someone really wants to accelerate the learning process, a qualified teacher is an absolute must in addition to a more diligent practice. In other words, you have to practice more and pay more attention to it. That is the only solution, I guess. Again, qualified instruction is very important. Without a good teacher, it is very hard to reach a good level. Finally, your third question. Does time have a big influence on achieving goals? Well, in my experience, yes, absolutely. However, making extra efforts can improve the efficiency in practice. So, if you can really focus when you practice and pay attention to details, you can make a lot of progress in a comparatively short period of time. Long story short, quality over quantity. Kazox770, I hope I have answered your question. let's move on to the next one. 内功 adept ask about limitations to power cultivation on one of my Xiudao video. Thank you, 内功 adapter, for your question. Before I answer them, I have to clarify the definition and the meaning of the term power in the Xiudao perspective. When we translate the term qi into English, we use the word power or energy. Actually, the Xiudao meaning of power and energy is not the same as in physics. More importantly, the Xiudao meaning of power and energy is also not the same as in martial art. In Xiudao, power or energy is just a metaphor for the mechanism of cultivation. It is used to express the inner transformation, including the mind, spirit, and so on. If you perceive Xiudao energy to be based on energy as used in physics, then that would be a mistake, and it is a very common mistake. So, energy and the power as used in physics usually have limits and can be measured. But the mind, spirit, and other energetic aspects of the body in Xiudao practice do not fit the definitions in physics. Therefore, there is no such limit to the amount of power that one can cultivate. Self-cultivation is about cultivation of mind, spirit, and other intangible parts of human life. There are no limits to refining yourself. I'm aware this answer is still very abstract. I will talk more about this in a future video. Thank you once again for this great question, and I hope my answer improves your understanding further. Let's move on to the next one. Anonymous asks, I quote, "In the past, I have heard a concept that teachers have used focus but not focus, be aware but not aware. Can you write the relevant sentence proverb in Chinese and please explain in detail?" End quote. Well, the concept you are asking about is 熟而不熟, 念而不念. 熟 means focus, 而 means but, 不 means without, 念 means be aware. Put together, 熟而不熟, 念而不念, means focus but not focus, be aware but not aware. There have been many documents written throughout Xiudao history that mention this concept, since it is a key element in Xiudao practice. 熟而不熟, 念而不念, sounds simple, but easier said than done. It reflects a key concept in Xiudao, which is called 火候. 火 means fire, which represents the level of intention. 后 means timing, or when one should intensify or ease one's intention. I have to say that the entire practice of Xiudao can be boiled down to the application of 火候. I recommend you watch my Xiudao video titled From Power of Nature to Nature of the Power, Wind and Fire, number 4, in which I have briefly talked about part of 火候. To summarize, Xiudao practice involves an overall neutral approach, which is the key concept of Dao De Jing. I will definitely talk about this topic more in the future, but I hope this answer suffices for today. Let's move on to the next one. Fred Talks asked two questions related to Li Dian and Dian Mai or Dian Mai. Before answering his questions, let me first briefly introduce Dian Mai. Dian Mai consists of two words. Dian means pressure, while Mai means meridian, Put together, it means a practice that add pressure on certain acupuncture points in martial application in order to create a significant effect on recipients' martial ability. Sometimes, and more commonly, people call it dian xue, since xue means acupuncture point. Now, let's look at Freddy's first question. It seems that Li Dian, and particularly the point of effect part of the concept, is very close to Dian Mai. Is it correct in assessment? Well, I have to say that Li Dian has nothing to do with Dian Mai, since Li Dian is the dynamic concept in martial art practice, while Dian Mai or Dian Xue is the specific technique. In Li Dian practice, one has to figure out the power transferring mechanism in martial application. Well, Dian Mai only targets specific points, which is rather static in nature. Now, let's look at Fred's second question. Could you please discuss more in depth about Dian Mai, its practice effects, mass, and so on, and how is it connected to internal martial art practice? I have a plan to introduce Dian Mai in a much more detailed manner in the future, but I would like to provide a brief answer here. Dian Mai or Dian Xue can only have a certain martial effects in combat. At the end of the day, if you want to apply Dian Mai in combat, you have to practice other martial techniques besides Dian Mai itself. In other words, if Dian Mai is your only skill set, you will be putting yourself at tremendous risk. Dian Mai is the technique, and of course, like anything else, it has been highly exaggerated in martial art movies. But in practice, the key practice is in being able to transfer power into your opponent's body in order to create a specific impact. For example, damage to organs or blocking energy circulation in the meridian system. Dian Mai is martial art agnostic. In other words, any martial artist can practice this style. One of my senior teachers, Hu Jinling, was good at Dian Mai since he practiced acupuncture in Tianjin. He understood acupuncture points way better than other martial artists of his time, which put him in an advantageous position. He was in the process of writing a book about it back then, for which I helped him in drawing the illustrations. But he did not get his book published for various reasons. That was more than 35 years ago. Again, I will talk more about Dian Mai in a future video. Fred, I hope my answers today suffice for now. Let's move on to the final question for today, also from Fred Talk. Fred Talks asks a question about the practice system that I introduced in my 100th lecture video. Link is in the description. In my 100th video, I shared my plans of working on an integrated system which includes internal style for martial arts, Shudao, and TCM as the three-pillar structure built upon Daoism, Confucianism, and other systems, and governed by the highest level, which is the practical philosophical system. So, let me read Fred's question now. Your three pillars structure implies that all three are integrated in one philosophical system. But a few times I ask you a question about internal martial arts from the point of view of interpretation of a TCM understanding. You seemed to suggest that it was wrong to look at it from that angle. Yet your system seems to suggest to have such a consolidated view. Could you please clarify how to look at each of the pillars from the other pillar's point of view? Thank you, Fred, for this question. This is a common phenomenon in communication that information alone is not sufficient for clear understanding. What introduced in the three-pillar system is to emphasize the standard-alone nature of each practice. In other words, when we practice martial arts, we should focus on the martial art itself, since the primary objective of martial practice is combat skill. However, if we analyze some other aspect of martial practice, such as health benefits, then you can use the TCM concept to explain it. What I emphasize in the system is to separate them in practice, but you always can analyze one pillar using other pillars or even modern physics. I always try to keep technical practice pure, but apply many means and methods to analyze them. For example, when introduced any term, I always talk about its historical, cultural, and social context so that the audience has a comprehensive picture. But in practice, when introducing a practice, I do not borrow any metaphorical terms in describing it. So we have to clearly identify the key function of each pillar and the way we analyze it. I hope my explanation has clarity now. So that brings us to the end of this month's Q&A. I really appreciate you all asking questions, and I hope my answers benefit your understanding of the relevant practice. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and enjoy your practice.